precious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 Bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Stop us, and if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher. than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is healer. Amen. Amen. Someone was asking me yesterday if I could hear you guys singing along with us as we sing up here, and I said no, but I sure hear your horns when you honk. So, not that you have to honk your horn right now, so. Right. Here's a couple of oldies. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. So praying as I onward go. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. By faith on heaven's tableland, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay, where some may dwell. Higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's dogs and me are joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost heights and catch a gleam of glory bright. I pray to heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. Lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher as I. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was this for crimes that I have done, be grown up on the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Some of you may not know what goes on up here because you're so far up there, but there are bees that fly around us up here and sometimes lands on us, and we keep on singing. So that happens sometimes, okay? So bear with us. That's the benefit of being outside. Sometimes I have ants that come marching across my music. It's kind of funny. Nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare your early before, your presence. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. There are many more. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. And fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let
let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
So many distractions, so many things that capture our thoughts. So many things grab the center of our heart, the throne of our heart. And as believers, we know that Jesus should be there on the throne of our heart. We're all guilty of being lured away by fears, by news, by our environment. And I just pray that we can just get rid of all these distractions, just focus in on the Lord. Would you empty all the garbage captivates my thoughts and takes me from you? Would you fill me with your mercy and the holiness that only comes from you? Take hold of my heart, O Lord, I belong to you. Hear my worship, takes me from you. Would you fill me with your mercy and the holiness that only comes from you? Take hold of my heart, O Lord, I belong to you. Hear my worship, hear
captivates my thoughts and takes me from you. Would you fill me with your mercy and the holiness that only comes from you? Take hold of my heart, oh Lord, I belong to you.
Stage, don't they? Amen.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are holy.
Jesus, you are holy.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are holy. Precious Lord,
Jesus, precious Lord,
send your Holy Spirit,
send your Holy Spirit,
Jesus, precious Lord,
Jesus, precious Lord,
send your Holy Spirit. I praise your name, for you alone, you alone, you alone, you alone, you alone.
And I praise
Father, I come before you this morning and I thank you. I thank you for continuing to pour out upon your church blessing after blessing, protection after protection. Lord, some here have experienced the effect of COVID even firsthand, with a family member or a friend or somebody being infected by this. Lord, would you continue to touch their lives? Would you continue to strengthen them and minister to them and encourage them this morning? Lord, would you continue to give us wisdom and understanding as the leadership of this church, as the pastor of this church? Lord, would you help me to do what's pleasing and right and honoring in your eyes? God, help us to be obedient to what you have for us. Lord, I think of Ron and Penny Chapman this morning and ask you to continue to minister to them. Lord, I'm not exactly sure what the update is or what the news is on Penny this morning, but you know the physical issue she was dealing with yesterday, and you know the seriousness of the situation, Lord. I pray that you would touch her body even now. Lord, minister to her. Bring healing and wholeness to her. Strengthen her. Take away that pain as only you can, Father God. Bring peace and comfort and encouragement to both of them and to their family, Lord God. And Father, I pray this morning that as we share your word together, you would speak to our hearts and encourage us. Help us to think outside of our own ideas, our own thoughts, and accept what you are telling us, Father God. Help us each to make the change in our own hearts that we need to make, the change that you are whispering to us in our ear as we listen to your word. Encourage us today, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Exodus chapter 22, starting at verse 1. If a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it, he must pay back 5 head of cattle for the ox and 4 sheep for the sheep. If a thief is caught breaking in and is struck so that he dies, the defender is not guilty of bloodshed. But if it happens after sunrise, he is guilty of bloodshed. A thief must certainly make restitution, but if he has nothing, he must be sold to pay for the theft. If a stolen animal is found alive in his possession, whether ox or donkey or sheep, he must pay back double. If a man grazes his livestock in a field or vineyard and lets them stray, and they graze in another man's field, he must make restitution from the best of his own field or vineyard. Over the past several weeks, we have gone from honoring our parents to honoring human life to honoring the sanctity of marriage. And today we're looking at respecting or honoring the things of others. We again read a simple 4-word command this morning. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 15. You shall not steal. A simple command. Yet as we review some different aspects of this command this morning, it might shock us how many of us, even sitting here at home or sitting here in the parking lot this morning, are guilty of breaking this particular command. As usual, we'll start by taking a look at the Old Testament and what God has to say about stealing there. From what we've read already in Exodus 22, we know that there is prescribed retribution for stealing. People had to pay a penalty for taking what did not belong to them. The cost was not a simple cost. Look at how it's laid out there. If you take one ox, it will cost you 5 head of cattle in return. Even if the livestock is found with that person, it wasn't just as simple as giving it back. That person had to pay back double for what they took. The penalty, whether you consider it stiff or not, was likely designed to deter people from taking stuff in the first place. That's kind of the idea of punishment. If you know what the punishment is going to be, hopefully you would not commit the sin or break the law as it talks about. Even if something was taken accidentally, the one guilty of taking the goods had to make repayment. We see that in the last part of the text that we read in Exodus 22. If a man's flock was grazing or eating out in the field, and it accidentally made its way into another man's field and ate there, restitution for what was eaten had to be made. The animal's owner had to pay back whatever part of that crop or field the flock had eaten from. Even though it was unintentional, he didn't do it on purpose. Someone else's goods were taken, and those goods must be paid back, and not just paid back with anything, paid back with the best of what that man could possibly offer. He wasn't allowed to give from his leftovers. He wasn't allowed to wait until the harvest was done and give some of the last trailings of the crop. He had to give back the best of what he had. Retribution, repayment had to be made, even if the theft was accidental. What other things does the Old Testament talk about in regards to theft? Well, one of the big ones was dishonesty in trading. You and I are not accustomed to the whole idea of bartering for things. That's just not how we function on a normal basis. We're used to writing a check, pulling out the credit card, using cash, whatever it is. We're not used to this barter system. But that was the typical way of purchasing or acquiring goods early on. But that was not always done fairly. People would trade this for that, but they found a way to cheat others out of what was due them. Deuteronomy, we see, as early as Deuteronomy, we see that man developed this system of cheating. Deuteronomy 25, starting at verse 13. Do not have two differing weights in your bag, one heavy, one light. Do not have two differing measures in your house, one large, one small. You must have accurate and honest weights and measures so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. For the Lord your God detests anyone who does these things, anyone who deals dishonestly. Amos chapter 8, starting at verse 4, we read something similar. Hear this, you who trample the needy and do away with the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over? When will we be able to sell grain and the Sabbath be ended so that we can market our wheat? Skimping the measure, boosting the price, cheating with dishonest scales, buying the poor with silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, selling even the sweepings with the wheat. Both of these are dealing with that idea of dishonest scales, dishonest measures, which put simply is thievery by the way of deception. Again, notice in the book of Deuteronomy, there was a perk for being honest, and there was a punishment for not being honest. It had to do with the time that they would be allowed to stay in the land that God had given them. In Amos, it talked about stealing from other people, but it also kind of made mention of stealing from God. How? By hurrying those festivals to an end, by bringing the Sabbath to closure before it was actually over. They were trying to hurry so they could get back to their dishonest sales. If we go back to Deuteronomy, we can also read about cheating people out of their appropriate or deserved pay. Deuteronomy chapter 24, starting at 14. Do not take advantage of a hired man who is poor and needy, whether he is a brother Israelite or an alien living in your towns. Pay him his wage each day before sunset, because he is poor and is counting on it. Otherwise, he may cry to the Lord against you, and you will be guilty of sin. In other words, pay the workman his due wage. Don't steal from them by paying them less than what you should pay them. Jeremiah 22 and verse 13. Woe to him who builds his palace by unrighteousness, his upper rooms by injustice, making his countrymen work for nothing, not paying them for their labor. Again, this is another sharp rebuke regarding stealing or cheating a person out of his due wages. While it may not seem like it to you and I, because we're not as accustomed to it, that very first word we read in Jeremiah, woe, W-O-E, woe, a simple three-letter word carried with it an incredibly strong meaning of judgment. Nobody ever wanted to hear the word woe spoken about them. We read through that and say, oh, okay, woe to you. No, no, no. No, this was an issue. This was a huge issue of judgment when you read that word. The Old Testament deals with this employer-employee relationship from the other side as well. Proverbs 18:9. One who is slack in his work is a brother to one who destroys. Or you could look at it this way. If you're not doing the work that you have been hired to do, then you're no better than the one who cheats the person out of the payment they should be receiving. You're equal in that. You have to do the work that you have been hired to do. Again, a fair day's work for a fair day's wages. It's a simple principle about being honest and fair regarding work and wages from both the employer and the employee standpoint. Most of what we've looked at or addressed so far is about person-to-person stealing in the Old Testament. What about people stealing from God? We spoke about this a few weeks ago when we talked about the Sabbath. Exodus 23, verses 10 and 11. For 6 years you are to sow your fields and harvest the crops, but during the seventh year let the land lie unplowed and unused. Then the poor among your people may eat food from it, and the wild animals may eat what they leave. Do the same with your vineyard and your olive grove. But it was because of the people's greed that the Israelites stole that year of rest that was due the land. God had set it up. God said, 6 years, harvest, 7 years, give it rest. Seventh year, give it rest. But the Israelites stole that year back because they wanted the harvest. They wanted the goods that they would get from that land. They used it as they saw fit, not as they had been directed by God to use it. How is that stealing from God? Because let's be honest, the land wasn't theirs to begin with. It was God's. It was God's, not theirs. God gave it to them. God gave them the direction on how to use it. And that principle is one that we too quickly forget today. What we own, what we possess, what we have isn't really ours to begin with. It's God's. He allows us to have it for a time. He allows us to use it for a time. He allows us to keep it for a time. And no one understood that better than Job. Job 1:21. Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Let's move over to the New Testament now and see what things we can gain, what understanding we can get from the New Testament text regarding stealing. Paul records for us a very direct statement regarding this idea of stealing and the believing convert. In the book of Ephesians, Paul writes about living as children of the light, or living the way we're supposed to live as changed, renewed, born-again believers in Jesus Christ. Who, by the way, are doing what but striving to be holy, right? Ephesians 4:28. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Stealing became an excuse for people. I don't have, therefore I'm going to steal to get what I need. That was the excuse that they developed. But that idea, that attitude, that concept of stealing is wrong. It was never intended to be the answer for any reason. Scripture makes that clear here. Stop stealing. Stop taking what is not yours. Do something that you can take ownership of. And don't just do it for yourself, but do it so that you might be able to give to those around you who are in greater need than you are. That's what he said here. Not only should you work for yourself, but so that you can give to those around you. The idea of working and earning, staying away from taking or stealing, is very much a New Testament command as it was an Old Testament command. Here lies the problem with us today. Here lies an area that many of us are guilty when it comes to this idea of stealing, even though we don't think we are. And it goes back to the employee-employer relationship. The worker is worth his wage. An employer should be honest with his employees. They should honor whatever agreement has been made between the two parties. They should not hold back what the employee deserves in terms of pay or wages given to them. Holding that back, deceiving them, coming up with some way, some way to manipulate the pay system is simply wrong. It's much the same as bartering with those dishonest weights or dishonest scales. And the employee needs to do their part as well, because the employee can be just as guilty today about stealing from the employer. Let's take a look at this. How many times has any one of us walked home with something that the company owns? I don't care if it's a sheet of paper or a pen or a stapler. if we leave the office and we take something that doesn't belong to us, it is stealing. Oh, the company has plenty of those. They'll never miss it. It's not a big deal. It's okay. No, it's not. If you have taken something belonging to your employer, you are a thief. I am a thief. It's just that simple. You know, crazy as it may sound, that kind of thing happens all the time at the church. People walk in and treat the church and the property of the church like it's their own personal goods and they can do with or take with what they want. Sorry, but that's not the case. You're stealing from the church if you do that. That might be a new thought or a new perspective, but if you're taking something that was not given to you or is not yours, that's thievery. What about this idea? What if it's lunchtime at work and we decide we need to go run a few errands on our lunch break, but it takes us a little longer than our normal lunchtime allows? Do we clock out? Do we report that to our supervisor? Or do we simply say, it's no big deal, it's only 15 minutes, nobody's gonna care? No. If we are not doing the work we have been hired to do, we are stealing from the company. In that case, we're stealing time and whatever else it is we've been hired to do. You know, we like to think of things, we like to justify things, we like to make ourselves out to be good people. But the bottom line is, some of these things we are guilty of, and we need to be honest about that. Let's go beyond the employee-employer relationship this morning. What about other things that we take? What about the idea of receiving something and never paying the bill for it? That, in essence, is stealing. Let me give you an example this morning. We agree to receive electricity into our home, and we agree to pay for that electricity that we receive and use, by the way, and we agree to do that for a price. They give it to me, they let me use it, I pay them for it. If we never pay that bill, we are stealing the goods, the services, the utilities that have been provided for us. They're used up. I can't give them back. But if we choose not to pay, we are thieves, stealing from the utility company. God gives us, God provides for us, God allows us to have everything we need. It is our responsibility to be wise with what He has given us and use it the way He has allowed us to use it. And that includes the finances that He has provided for us day after day. I'm going to give you one more example this morning because this is another one that none of us ever like to hear about, think about, or talk about. But we need to think about it from this perspective. How many of us report all of the income appropriately on our tax returns? None of us get excited about paying taxes. I get that. But that does not give us the right to be dishonest on our taxes. It is essential that we report what we have been given to report. And if we choose to lie or omit information on our taxes, then we are wrong. We are stealing what does not belong to us. You know, the word told us, we talked about this a week or so ago, abide by the law of the land. It didn't say like the law you abide by, it says abide by them. And there are laws for us to follow. Jesus himself said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's. Now, he was not justifying unfair taxation there, no, but he was making a point. In essence, he was saying, let them have that worthless stuff. They're asking for it. Let them have it. Trust in me and I will provide for you. Give yourself back to me and I will meet your needs. I'll give you everything that you have to have in order to survive. But be honest and be upright and be fair and be obedient in all of it. And if you do that, I will meet your needs. We could go on with several other ideas or concepts this morning, things that we can consider, like how many of us have walked out of a hotel room and taken something that doesn't belong to us? How many people have kept the extra change we were given even though we knew it was too much? How many of us have plagiarized when we worked with written material? How many of us have acquired or used copywritten material that we didn't pay for? We could go on and on about different types of theft. Again, in our own selfish act of justification, we like to pretend that things are not as bad as they truly are. We like to twist things around so that we don't appear or look or feel guilty, when in fact, at times, we are. We have a skewed concept of this commandment. And we think that as long as I don't steal somebody's car or their bank account or $1 million, then I'm justified and it's okay. But God never put those parameters on that command. He used 4 words, you shall not steal. Those are the words that he chose to use. We're going to look at one more thing quickly this morning, and this actually takes us back to the Old Testament this morning, back to the book of Malachi, where he poses a question to the people. Chapter 3, starting at verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. You asked, how do we rob you? In tithes and offerings. You are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I do not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. We're not going to dig into this whole idea of tithing this morning. That would be a whole nother message in and of itself. But the point is to be mindful this morning. When we talk about stealing, are we guilty of stealing from our God? I know we don't want to view it that way, but that bottom line is what it is. Are we guilty of stealing from him? And I'm not just talking about tithes and offerings here. We're talking about time, talent, willingness to serve, which we are all called to do. How many of us are stealing from God in those ways because we choose not to honor or obey him in what he asks of us? And yes, God has asked every one of us to give in those ways. There are 3 ways we can receive things. We can work for them, earn money, pay for them, buy them. We can earn them. We can receive them as gifts from people. Or we can take what does not belong to us, Or in the case of God, we can withhold what he has asked us to give. That is called stealing. And that is not okay. Exodus 20 and verse 15. You shall not steal. Father, we come before you this morning. And again, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you give to us the instructions that you have given us. Lord, we don't always like what they say. We don't always like how they apply to us in our lives, but they're here for our benefit, for our sake. They're here that we might change and become more like the person you want us to be. Lord, help us to understand that today. Help us to do a true, powerful self-examination this morning and understand where we are, even in this command of stealing. It's not about grand theft. It's not about the big things, but all those little things that we justify away. God, would you help us to overcome that skewed concept of thinking today? Help us to become obedient children, obedient servants to you today, Father God. Teach us, Lord, that we might honor you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Oh, amen. 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 Children and the children and the children, may his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and the children and the children. rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you. To you, Lord, turn his face toward you and give you.